Hi everyone, today I'm going to go through laryngeal mask airways, also known as LMAs or supraglottic airway devices. I'm going to go through how to place the LMA and also all the ways we can optimize and troubleshoot when things go wrong and also give you a context of how to use it. So let's get started. So the first disclaimer, obviously patients who are hypoxemic or not ventilating well, these are high risk situations, and the LMA again falls in the context of a whole plan for resuscitation. So first of all, I like to give, like with all my talks, a strategy and a framework for the way that I'm going to be approaching this. So I imagine that airway management is really trying to optimize oxygenation ventilation through any of these means, bag mask ventilation, intubation, we've got a couple of videos for that, as well as the LMA. Now, if these aren't working and we're in a can't intubate, can't oxygenate scenario, then you'll be thinking of a surgical airway or front of neck access, which is a whole other topic as well. And you'll definitely need to be calling for help and only doing things that you're comfortable doing and know how to do it and also manage the problems and complications that could occur. So with that in mind, let's get started with LMA ventilation. So a laryngeal mask airway is really a device that just sits over the trachea and the laryngeal opening. And this then creates a seal which allows us to positive pressure ventilate. So again, just like the bag mask or the intubation, what you're doing is you're creating a seal with a certain structure and then using positive pressure to ventilate through this tube and inflate the lungs. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to demonstrate on this airway anatomy model. So again, where I'm going to place this LMA really is just sitting past the tongue with the opening and aperture just above where the cords are. And that way you'll get ventilation down this tube and into the airway. The LMA that I just showed you is a first generation or classic LMA. Now the second generation LMAs pretty much have a couple of different things going on. One of the main things is they have a gastric port. So this is a Proseal. You can see a gastric port there as well as the aperture where you can ventilate from. Same with the Supreme LMAs, which I'll go in a bit more detail later. I've got a gastric port there as well as the normal airway ventilating port. Now the iGels, which we have on our resus trolleys at our hospital, also have this little gastric port again at the tip. Having this extra gastric port means that you might be able to identify regurgitation as it happens and then manage it by putting a nasogastric in or in alternatively intubating the patient. So next we're gonna go through is insertion technique. Now that you've seen where the LMA sits in that anatomical model, you could probably make sense of what you need to do. So essentially, there's a couple of different ways that you can insert this LMA, but the most common one is to push it past the tongue straight back. So what I do is I usually open the head just like that. So do a head tilt that opens the mouth. Often you can get your assistant to just open up the mouth like so, and that allows you to place this in. You need the minimal aperture that you need is about 2 centimeters. So just remember that if you have a patient with very small or limited mouth opening, you'll need a low profile, potentially like a fast track LMA to make sure that you're able to get it through to 2 centimeters, probably the bare minimum you need. So I've got the mouth open, I push it back. Now the first resistance you're gonna get is the tongue. So you really, sometimes you get a resistance there that doesn't allow you to place it. So what I have to do is I just need to apply a light bit of pressure and that then sits correctly and you'll feel a bit of a pop and a rise in the larynx as that goes down. So just to demonstrate that insertion again, I tilt the head back. I might get an assistant to open the mouth or even try to open it myself. I push it past the teeth gently and then I'll push backwards so it goes along the upper palate, the hard palate, and then down the soft palate past the tongue. Again, sitting just above the airway, the trachea, which allows ventilation. Again, as always, I check ventilation. You can see the rise and fall of the chest, and sometimes that's all you need. Other times you'll inflate the cuff, and it's already got some zones marked out. Essentially, you want to inflate that cuff and try to create a better seal. So one of the common things that happens is that as you place the LMA in, sometimes it just gets stuck at the posterior pharynx. So what you need to do is sometimes follow the curvature of your hard and soft palate and then push it around the tongue. So I'm actually forcing backwards with a bit of pressure and that allows it to get past the tongue more easily. So that's one of the first things I do. Again, there's many ways that this can go wrong. So really, no matter what you're doing, you have to continuously assess that you're ventilating, so rise and fall of the chest, and that you're getting fogging in the tube and hopefully end-tidal CO2 trace. as well as the saturations are appropriate and safe for this patient. So let's say you're trained to put an LMA in and you've put that LMA in and you're trying to ventilate this patient, but you simply can't ventilate. For example, there might be an obstruction or it might be too great a leak. So I've got a few things that I can do. And as I mentioned in a few of my other videos, the common things are I could position the patient better or I could provide paralysis. Again, paralysis can be very tricky. You've got to know how to manage the complications of paralysis before giving any of these very dangerous drugs. So positioning paralysis are ways I can optimize any of these airway situations. That specifically for LMAs, just like with having a mask on your face or an endotracheal tube, the size and the type are mainly the things that I can adjust. So this one I've got as a size 4. If there's too much of a leak, I can either use a size 5 LMA, so go up in size, or put a bit more air in the cuff. Generally speaking, you want to go for a higher size and put less air in the cuff. That just minimizes the chance of trauma to the airway. Now, the type of LMA is also an interesting thing. So when we looked at studies of LMAs in action, the classic LMA, this one that you see here, had a 93% first insertion success rate, whereas some of the second generation only had maybe above an 80% success rate first time. However, with 3 attempts, that rose to 100% in most of these circumstances. So just know that the classic LMA is actually a really effective device, and the other second generation LMAs are really quite effective as well, but each LMA type may have its advantage and disadvantage. So if it's not working for me, if I've got a leak, I'll definitely move up in size. So if I've tried a different size LMA, it just doesn't seem to fix the problem, I can then try a different type of LMA, whether it's a Proseal, a Supreme, or an iGel, or one of the newer devices that will be out in the market. Now, one of the other troubleshooting steps that I do is do microadjustments. So this is something you may have not heard of before, but let's say I've got an LMA that's just not working perfectly adequately. I might just do these micro insertions up and down of the LMA, and I might even just tilt the head back and forth just to find if there's an optimal position. Now, as I'm talking about optimization steps for LMAs, just know that unlike bag mask ventilation, repeated attempts in an LMA can cause harm. So when I think about this, really a lot of the guidelines out there say that you should have maximum 2 or 3 attempts at inserting an LMA. If it doesn't work in 2 or 3 attempts, go back to bag mask ventilation because multiple insertions of the LMA can cause trauma. Now, one of those things that National Audit Project studies reported, and these were big studies showing data about airway problems, it showed that repeated attempts at intubation and LMA insertion could cause trauma to the airway and make a manageable airway an impossible to manage airway. That means that trauma to the airway could cause swelling, which means that now, instead of just being able to go back to bag masking and safely manage a patient, now I have an obstructed airway, which is a can't intubate, can't oxygenate airway. So again, don't have repeated attempts if you're failing each time. A maximum of 2 or 3 times is all you want to do. If that fails, go back to bag masking, and as always, call for help and assistance. Now, the final situation that I would use LMAs in context would, again, be referring back to the Difficult Airway Society algorithm and guidelines and the vortex approach. So if I've got a situation where I've got a patient I'm giving an anesthetic to and I've got an unexpected difficult airway, I've tried bag mask ventilation, I've optimized Gadel, nasopharyngeal, 2 hands, jaw thrust and everything, and I can't oxygenate, I try to get a view with the laryngoscope and it's a grade 4 view and I don't have maybe a video laryngoscope handy or it's on the way, I would then put in one of these LMAs as my rescue device. So again, I'm just trying to maintain oxygenation while planning for other things, planning for another operator with maybe a video laryngoscope and an endotracheal intubation or front of neck access. So remember, all of these techniques are really important to learn in context. So I just want to go through some of the key differences between the classic LMA and the second generation LMA. So there's quite a few second generation LMAs, including the iGel, the Supreme, and the Proseal. And there'll probably be more in the market as well. There's another airway device also called the Fast Track, which is purpose-built to be able to intubate through. Now, this classic LMA, again, really is this airway tube, then an inflatable cuff, and an aperture there by which you can ventilate. The second generation LMAs have a few different features to them. Generally speaking, the second generation LMAs have a gastric port, which is this one that we've shown before, and that sits often at the tip of the LMA and leads out. They often all have a bite block here. So if you can see with the iGel, this is a really firm structure here, and it's roughly sitting at this line. So where your teeth are at that line, it's a very strong plastic, which means if the patient bit down, they can't obstruct here, which is really important. If you have an obstructed tube, that's obviously a real problem for ventilation. Same with the Supreme device. It is preformed and it sits with the teeth along this aperture here. And again, that's very hard plastic. So the final thing that makes second generation potentially more useful than a classic LMA is the fact that they can generate higher pressures for ventilation. So the classic LMA, 20 centimeters, maybe 30 centimeters water maximum pressure for insufflation, whereas these devices can potentially go 20 above that and sometimes even up to a total of 60 centimeters water. So generally speaking, with the iGel, with the Supreme, with the Proseal even, you'll get high insufflating pressures. Some numbers quote anywhere from 40, even up to 60 centimeters of water. Now, this is not always the easiest thing to do. Now, there's always a problem. So for example, if I'm generating that much pressure, there's always the risk that I might insufflate the stomach, which means air in the stomach causing increased pressure in the stomach, and that increases my risk of aspiration as well. So even though I'm able to generate high pressures to ventilate, this is not always the most advisable thing to do. And again, I'll be using this in an emergency situation if I'm going to be generating high pressures. So imagine that now in the resus context. That's why these second generation LMAs are actually quite a useful device. I've got a patient who's unfasted and deteriorating on the ward outside of a theater or a critical care environment. I really want a device that potentially people who aren't as trained in intubation can still do and still insert pretty safely. So now, if I use a second generation LMA like the iGel, it's pretty easy to insert. I can use high pressures because occasionally the patient might be sick with sick lungs, obstructive or restrictive lung disease, or obesity. So I can generate higher pressures to create some safe ventilation oxygenation. But also if the patient's unfasted and they do regurgitate, hopefully that regurgitant liquid will go through that gastric tube and then give me an indication. I'll also be able to put a small nasogastric tube through there, allowing me to drain that stomach. So there's a few advantages with these second generation LMAs. Now, these aren't necessarily borne out in studies. It makes good sense that they would provide an advantage, but it would take really large numbers in randomized controlled trials to prove absolutely definitively that this is the case. So what I might do is, using the iGel, I'll demonstrate where it sits in this anatomical model. We've got the gastric port just there. What I do now is, as I place this in, this gastric port will sit and hopefully block the esophagus so that it prevents any aspirant or aspiration or gastric contents going up into the posterior pharynx and potentially being inhaled, causing an aspiration injury. With the other ones as well. So here's a Supreme LMA. Again, a similar design. It's got a gastric port as well as a normal ventilation port. And that again sits in the proper place, blocking off the gastric, the esophageal opening. And this will be that gastric port there. Proseal, one of the first second generation LMAs. Again, you can see that gastric port there and that sits just above the esophageal opening. And then you can see where the ventilatory port sits. Now this has quite a large drain tube, so it probably makes it easier to use a nasogastric tube to drain the stomach if it needs to be drained. Again, the same technique, simply tilt the head back, open the mouth, and then I'm pushing it down and following that curvature around the back there. The iGel doesn't require insufflation. This structure here simply sits there and molds to the right position. Again, the Supreme, very similar technique. Place it, and then I might inflate the cuff to make sure that it's working adequately. Now, this is the Proseal. Again, similar technique. Often you'll find that this comes with an introducer. So what I'm going to do is the variation of the technique. The introducer provides this flexible LMA with more structure, but in the correct situation, and with gloves on and, you know, providing all that proper hygiene, I can insert it past without needing the introducer. So thanks very much for watching. This is ABCs of Anesthesia. We've gone through LMAs, the optimization, the strategy, how to troubleshoot, and kind of the reasons for different styles of LMA. So I hope that was interesting. Please share with anyone who might be interested, and I'll see you next time.